to him. When I need a healing in my body, oh, I'll reach out and touch his robe. I cry out to you, Lord, have mercy on my soul. I reach out and touch his robe. I reach out and touch the hem of his garment. Reach out and touch his robe. I cry out, Lord, through the power of the Holy Ghost. Reach out and turn me whole. With sin and his passion, reach out and touch his robe. Helps you turn away from bad. I reach out and touch his robe. The hem of his garment. Reach out and touch his robe. Through the power of the Holy Ghost, reach out and touch his robe. And she broke through the crowd and touched the hem that day, was healed, made whole. She hem of his garment, reach out through. She power of the Holy Ghost, reach out and touch his robe.
Tonight, can't put my finger on it. Would you guys welcome our special guest, the brothers McClurg? My name's Trey. If you're new with this, we want to welcome you. Thank you so much. I got to meet these guys at a Cup Trip Leader Conference here at Westside, and I thought, man, Westside would love it. We've been trying to find a good date to have you come in, and coincidentally, when they said, hey, then I'm like, sure, and it did not occur to me that Westside Family Festival. And I go, hey, I got an idea. How about you guys play in the afternoon at the festival? And you play that afternoon, come to 5 o'clock service and enjoy you some more. So this is a really great worship all morning here at Westside. So you're really in for a treat. If you're new with that in your relationship with God, above all things, we want you to know that you're welcome in this community. Wherever you're at on your journey, we're just so glad that you're here. This is a great place for you to come and explore the claims of Christ. For your presence with us. Thank you, Jesus, for music. Get to come and gather together in your name, that we as a community have the same heart and the same mind as we focus in and we ask, God, that you open up our hearts, be honored by our humility, and that you. Amen.
Thanks for joining us for worship. If you're new, we'd love to connect with you and help you take your next step. Tear off that Connect card and sign up for one of the many opportunities at Westside.
Then drop it off before you leave today. If you're watching online, click the Connect card button beneath the video or use the Westside app.
If you're ready to take that next step to be baptized, we have an incredible opportunity for you on Sunday, October 1st.
We will be holding baptisms in all services. And we can't think of a better time to demonstrate our love for Jesus.
Baptism is a public expression of your personal commitment to Jesus Christ. If you'd like to know more, take this next step to be baptized, check baptism on your Connect card or visit westsidefamily.church/baptism.
If you are currently facing emotional or spiritual challenges, find encouragement and accountability in Lifelines. These biblically based support groups focus on helping people strengthen their marriages and families, recover from addiction, find financial freedom, heal from past hurts, grieve in community, and overcome spiritual challenges.
Lifeline leaders are committed to walking alongside you as you learn to experience God's presence in all circumstances.
If you're in need of support, take advantage of these groups starting this week.
Family is meant to be there for acceptance, the occasional challenge, and consistent encouragement.
At Westside, we take that idea pretty seriously, and we would like to invite you to join our family. Join us at Get Connected, where you can find your place in a family that is growing right here.
No matter what life stage you're in, you'll find acceptance, encouragement, and a challenge to take that next step in your faith.
If you haven't been a part of our Get Connected experience yet, let's explore loving Jesus, becoming like Jesus, and sharing Jesus together.
Well, good evening. How's everybody doing? Good. Well, we come all the way from Buffalo, New York, to be with you. Yeah, we walked all the way here. I'm just kidding. That was a lame joke. Our Bills lost today, but we wanted to say something to you guys. Thanks for beating the Patriots a couple of weeks ago. Yeah. Yeah, the Bills have beat the Patriots like we weren't born yet, so one of these days we're going to get it back. But thanks again for having us. We know that you probably didn't have much of a say in the matter, but we are still glad to be here with you tonight. And let's stand up together as we sing a few songs. Oh, Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great, how great thou art, how great thou art. hidden glory in creation, now revealing you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What can separate us now? Sing it out. What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold the veil tore before you. You silence the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names. Sing it out. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. Oh, your name is powerful. Oh, the name above all names. Oh, the name above all names. God. Oh, the name. Sing this with us. You can make a way, you can make a way, you are the way maker. You can make a way, you can make a way, you are the way maker. We lift. Lift our eyes up, lift our eyes up to the way maker. Lift our eyes up, lift our eyes up to the way maker. You can make. You are the way maker. We live.
can. You can make a way, you can make a way. You are the way maker. You can make a way, you can make a way. You are the way maker. Lift their eyes up to the way maker. Lift their eyes up to the way. You can make a way, you can make a way. You are the way maker, yes you are. You can make a way, you can make a way. You are the way maker. We lift our eyes up to the way maker. Lift our eyes up to the way
presence, knowing that through your Son and the death on the cross, that we can stand here this evening as your sons and your daughters, that you have made a way for us. To be able to lay our hurts at your feet. Be able to celebrate the good things in life. To be able to meet together in a beautiful place like this tonight. So, Father, I pray you'd open our eyes and our ears, our hearts to what is said tonight. May we pay attention. Give you honor and praise. In your name we pray. Everybody said, hey, thanks for letting us worship with you tonight. We appreciate it very much. Thank you. Thank you. With that said, you can go ahead and have a seat. Now stand back up. No, I'm just kidding. Sit down.
Jesus is in the recycling business. It's time to move from the sorry cycle to recycle. In other words, Jesus can rectify what I've wrecked. Jesus can actually salvage what I've shattered. Jesus is the one who can transform what I've trashed, and he is the one who looks at our garbage and regrets through the mercy eyes of an artist and sees possibilities for creation and creativity rather than just useless junk. Jesus is in the recycling business. He is the only one who can get us out of the sorry cycle into recycling. And over the last few weeks, I couldn't help but notice the parallels between the steps out of the sorry cycle and the process we all go through in order for our city to recycle our garbage. Think about it. First of all, you have to sort out the things that you want to be recycled. I have to take the time to sort out that stuff into a separate bin, the green one. And on more than one occasion, I've been busted by Michelle for not sorting. She'll say, "Who left all these aluminum cans in the garbage cans?" Like me, guilty. See, to leave them there, that would mean to waste them. And in the same way, the first step to move from the sorry cycle to recycle is sorting out our regrets. That means we must recognize our regrets, not ignore them or hide them, but sort them out. Acknowledge them before God, ourselves, and others. This is what happened when Nathan confronted David and said, "You are that man," regarding his adultery and the ensuing murder. And David had to get his regrets sorted out rather than keep hiding them. And maybe you've been walking around for years with pain and regret, and it's directly affecting the way you see the world, the way you relate to others, but you haven't been willing to sort them out. And sorting means you have to identify the pain or its source, the lies that were embedded into your life through that regret. And part of Jesus' recycling is for you to time to sort out your pain. From that, you can see you did stuff that happened. You must continue willing to let towards the second step cycle, regrets. We can them if releasing our regrets and that regret. Have mercy according to your vision as you reset this by adapting. And that's literally what recycling is, to adapt to a new year. The amount of recycled products today is in cars, bags, and bikes, literally. Even here, the recycling can be built. And all of that compared to the creators of regrets and made broken. And a look that we and
like. Then I start watching basketball. Good sports. Like when people take watching CrossFit games. It seems like those guys out amongst all of them is amazing. I mean, he was setting medals won way back, cemented as the greatest swimmer. Is what happened to Phelps. It almost seems like they even empty ships swimming. No, to be better off, the best thing. Fame, survival syndrome, and it seems like everything. We see that narrative. His family and friends and gave him a book to believe greatly on this. For Phelps, it changed. He certainly a turning point in his life. Wouldn't be where I am today had it not that moment. Also, today's big idea that, and for those, the story of redemption is allowing to take everything from our past. Our greatest example of this is things. It's the things that give you shame, the house, the thing ever. And remember, and it was late. It was. Hi, Daddy. Regret. True for in history. And the relationship, but he's also Bathsheba. David, his story, and had lots of military syndrome, where he was doing very and continued cycling process, and he went to her thinking son, but now a new son is born, adds his blessing onto God's beloved, and you know through that Solomon came. For the whole country, this man alive. A second again, mind often pain and God most clear of recycling God. He was racist, West, and God had fail to get him to change his mind. And will swallow you up until you have that pain. A guy that some trip here with Westside to Thailand is one of that's his nickname because his normal anyway. But and the reason for that, if you ask him, of a gang and got mixed up with the wrong crowd and ended up, I don't know how, making a lot of people mad in the gang and in kind of a weird watching on TV, jail. And I said, man, I need to make a change. Sometimes realize that we need to make a change. His experiences when he came to Jesus and let Jesus recycle that regret into redemption, into ways where he ministers to other prisoners in Thailand, teaches them trades, helps them get out of that, and starts that whole recycling, redemption story. He helps rescue little girls from sex trafficking out on the borders of Thailand and Laos and Myanmar, and brings them in and gives them hope. It is a beautiful, beautiful thing when you go and see it for yourself. But it all started with regret. And so the question then becomes, for you, it probably isn't hard for you to remember a regret right now. But the question is, do I need to let Jesus recycle my regret into a new direction? And then what is that new direction? Think about that. Because Jesus recycles regret into new transformation in me. Not only does he want me to realize I need a different direction, but he starts to transform that regret in like this spiritual jujitsu that's amazing and converts it into something completely different. Seeing the bottom drop out of your self-made plans can cause you to drop to your knees in humility, which is the perfect posture for allowing God to work in our lives. And that's when we really grow spiritually. Like, for example, with Paul, he says in Corinthians, we were crushed and overwhelmed, and we saw how powerless we were to help ourselves, but that was good. Do you catch that? You catch what he says? That was good. For when we put everything into the hands of God who could save us, he did help us. You don't know that God is all you need until God is all you've got. When you've lost it all and you're falling apart and don't know that God is all you need and until you realize he's all you got. And if you've ever had a problem, you'd never know how God could solve them. God allows regret to teach you to depend on him. And David describes it this way in Psalm 119. It was the best thing that could have happened to me. Think about that. Have you ever heard people say that before when it comes to tough times in their life? It was the best thing that could have happened to me, for it taught me to pay attention to your laws. The truth is, some things we only learn through pain, and it's the only way that we're going to learn them. It reminds me of a verse in James that says, consider it pure joy, my brethren, when you face trials of many kinds. Why? Because it's fun? No. No problem is any fun, but because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance, and that perseverance must finish its work so that you can be mature and complete, not lacking anything. God wants you to be mature. God wants you to be complete. He wants you to be at peace and to be satisfied, lacking nothing, and to have it all together. How do you get it all together? Through your problems and regrets. There's no shortcuts. There's no such thing as instant character. There's no such thing as instant maturity or instant greatness. I mean, we have instant coffee. We got instant soup. We try to pop things in the microwave, everything you can microwave right now. But God doesn't microwave your regrets. He puts them in a crock pot. This reminds me of one particular scenario. My mom, and I'll never forget this either. There was one Thanksgiving meal where we had people over, and she made way too many baked potatoes. You know what I'm talking about? Just, they were all over the place, and she was about ready to throw them away, but because we didn't have a ton of money and she was the frugal type, she thought, well, I'll figure out what to do with these things. And so she's like, we'll have twice baked potatoes or whatever, I don't know. And so she stuck them in the crock pot, and then, you know, they were just all mealy and weird, and she was like, ah. So she threw a stick of butter in there, and then she threw, you know, some cream cheese in there and a little bit of heavy cream and just started making this thing. And dude, they were amazing. They were the best mashed potato. From then on, those were the mashed potatoes that everybody wanted every single year. Every time that we had people over, we had to have these twice-baked mashed potatoes. Now, they took forever to make. They took forever to cook. They were amazing. And many times we want, and when I sit down with people, when I'm counseling with people, they want their regrets fixed right away. And I don't blame them. They want the pain to go right away. I don't blame you. But God doesn't work that way. God isn't going to fix your marriage just like that. He's not. You're not going to get skinny just like that. It's just not going to happen. I mean, it's just not going to happen. There's so many things, so many regrets that we have. You're not going to get financially free immediately. You're probably not going to win the lottery. It just doesn't happen that way. It takes time. And sometimes we tend to panic when our regrets don't get redeemed right away. And sometimes redemption takes months. Sometimes it takes years. And I know that you don't like to hear this, but it's true. If you start looking at different types of biblical stories, like Moses, for example, I mean, he seriously blew it when he first started. It took him 40 years to get to a place where God could actually use him. I know that doesn't sound encouraging, but God used him in incredible ways after that, that changed history. Paul, he was 7 years, maybe 10, depending upon estimates the scholars say, between the time that he was the terrorist and the time that he was Paul the Apostle as we know him. Now, that's a long time. And I generally don't tell people that I'm counseling with, oh, wait 10 years. I don't say that because it's not helpful. We want the microwave solution. But God doesn't tend to work that way. God redeemed Paul's closed-minded legalism and turned him into the greatest missionary in history. So then the question then becomes for you, do I need to let Jesus recycle my regret into transformation in me? The whole recycling process is expensive. It takes a while, but the stuff that comes out on the other end is amazing. Jesus recycles regret into a new direction for me, a new transformation in me, and the last one is a new compassion through me. God wants to use your experiences and even your regrets to help other people. He wants to use you with your regrets. Usually we think Jesus uses only real gifted, talented people, but that's not true. A lot of times we think God uses our strengths, and God does use our strengths in many ways. But if I'm up here and speaking, you know, if I'm halfway decent, you know, and I'm using my strengths, sometimes you would look at me and say, oh, that's great, but I can't do that. But when I share with you how I neglected my family because of my career and even thought that I was doing the right thing because it was wrapped in this little God envelope while my kids didn't even know who I was, you can probably relate to that. You could probably relate to parent guilt, parent regret, right? You can probably relate to a lot of dumb things that I've done in my life. And it's those very weaknesses that allow Jesus to recycle them and to redeem them into ways that actually help people. Because when guys come to me and their marriage is kind of rocky because they've devoted so much of their time to their careers and they talk to me, I know exactly how they feel. And I don't judge them. I work with them because I understand how knuckleheaded they are because I am still working through those things, and I'm a whole lot wiser now than I used to be because of it, and God is redeeming those things in me. And as you share from your hurts, your habits, your hang-ups, of the things that you've recovered from, God wants to use you, and that's what God uses. And when you understand this, that God uses your weaknesses and your pain, life takes on a whole new meaning. Because Jesus never wastes a hurt. He never wastes a regret. He'll recycle them. And he'll allow you to share what you've learned with other people. My regrets in my life give me a ministry to others, and it makes me humble at the same time. And I don't know if you noticed in the pulse, before we even started, all these lifelines and the faces of all of those people, whether it be people helping others through regrets of addiction or a divorce or all kinds of other scenarios, are wounded people who have gone through the same thing and have allowed Jesus to recycle their regrets and to redeem them to help others. And it just reminds me of this passage of scripture that Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 1:4. Why does God do this? So that when others are troubled, needing our sympathy and encouragement, we can pass on to them the same help and comfort that God has given us. Everybody needs recovery of some type. Mental recovery, physical recovery, spiritual recovery, social recovery, relational recovery. We all have hurts and hang-ups and habits. Nobody's perfect. And who better to help that person who's struggling with alcoholism than a former alcoholic? Who better? Who better to help somebody through their financial problems than someone who has made it on the other side of financial bankruptcy and worked his way out of it? Who better to help parents with their teenagers that are just kind of running off the rails than parents who have gone through the exact same thing with their kids? And I know that recovering addicts who have become counselors, helping others in their journey of healing. So then we just need to be humble. We just need to be real. Not to lecture, but just share your story, share your hurt, share your regret with others. Nobody's perfect. And yes, the church is full of hypocrites. Welcome, we all are. The question is, do I need to let Jesus recycle my regret into new compassion for others? And who can I share my story with? Who can I serve? Redemption takes a lot of different forms. But Jesus is giving you and every one of us a choice when it comes to our regrets. We can stay stuck in them or we can start over. It's your choice. And I'm not saying that redemption is easy or that it's simple. And it's often challenging and complex, but it does begin with a simple choice. What will it be for you? In the bottom of your notes, there's three different options, probably the three different paths that you could take. The first one says, I'm ready to start over. I'm ready to recognize and release my regrets. Jesus, I need a fresh start. We're here to help you with that. The second one says, I'm ready to move forward. I'm ready to recycle my regrets like I've seen others do. And Jesus, I'm ready to serve others. And then if we're being honest, the third one is valid too. I'm not ready. I'm not ready yet. And Jesus, I need more information. But keep coming. Join the club. We all have regrets. We all need Jesus to help us recycle them and redeem them into something beautiful. And he has a creative way of doing that time and time again. I want you to know that God wants to take your story of regret and turn it into a story of redemption. Let's pray. Right now, with your eyes closed and your head bowed, I want you to just imagine using that gift that God has given you, your imagination. And I invite you to see Jesus, who's fully present right here with us. Picture Jesus with a recycle bin right by him. With your mind's eye, those regrets that have come to your mind as I've been speaking, place your regrets in that recycle bin. Jesus, I pray for every soul in this room who has put their regret in the bin and allowed Jesus to put it out on the curb to recycle it. I pray that you'd take it and that you would recycle the regret, that you'd rectify what we've wrecked, that you've salvaged what we've shattered. Let it change directions for us. May it be transformed in us for a new life, new wisdom, new character, new humility that causes new compassion and hope to flow through us for others. And that you would use your infinite creativity so that on the other side of that regret, we can even say, I'm so grateful for how your recycling process has redeemed it. And that we look back and almost are grateful for that time, because we knew that if it weren't for that pain, we wouldn't have changed and we wouldn't have seen your redemption and the beauty that you brought out of it. And I know that one day when we're up with you in heaven and we see your big redemption project that you've done with all the pain and all the hurt, that it's gonna be amazing. May that heaven's peace and awe be be brought to us today as we see you recycle and redeem our regrets as we help others with them. In Jesus' name and with that same authority, I ask as your children. Amen. Well, if you want to talk to somebody about your regrets, got a couple of folks, I'll be here. Would love to talk with you, pray with you. But please recycle, okay? I think you'll be better for it. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next week.
When your fear is crying.